Good evening, everyone. Our presentation will begin shortly, but before we get started, a few housewarming details to take care of here. First of all, I would like to respectfully ask that you dig into your purses and wallets and pants pockets and retrieve your electronic devices and put them on silent or vibrate, please, during the presentation. Your cooperation there would be most helpful. And also, since we do not have a program in print, just to sort of give you the big picture of what we're doing here, I'm going to do an introduction of Mary. She's going to do a presentation that will last approximately 1 hour, followed by an opportunity for Q&A. All right, so sit back and relax. I'll give you a few moments to get your phones fixed, and then we'll start. Good evening, everyone. On behalf of our president, Dr. Torrey Herring Smith, and the Board of Trustees, I welcome you this evening to Washington and Jefferson College. My name is John Zimmerman, and I'm the Vice President for Academic Affairs here at the college, and I welcome you this evening to a very special event for our college. I first want to thank some folks. I want to thank our grantors, the J. Robert Maxwell and Benedum Funds, our Education Department, the Conflict and Resolution Studies Concentration Team, in particular, Richard Easton, all the administrative departments and aides, food service directors and staff who have worked so hard to make this evening possible. Their work has indeed resulted in an especially good and unique event. This evening, W&J presents Mary Montague, a voice of hope that has for decades revealed what an individual can do to change communities torn by violence, divisiveness, and intransigence. Late in life, George Bernard Shaw, Irish author, wrote, quote, "I am of the opinion that my life belongs to the community, and as long as I live, it is my privilege to do for that community whatever I can. I want to be thoroughly used up when I die, for the harder I work, the more I live. Life is no brief candle to me. It is a sort of splendid torch which I have got hold of for just a moment, and I want to make sure that it burns as brightly as possible before handing it on to the next generation." End quote. Our speaker this evening, Northern Ireland's own Mary Montague, as well as her husband Patrick, indeed embodies Shaw's words. Mary Montague, personal witness to murder and violence, helped to broker the Northern Ireland peace agreements. She has continued to work in peacemaking, reconciliation, and mediation for over 40 years, and she has done this work throughout the world. She has worked in Kosovo, the Balkans, Pakistan, Afghanistan, Sudan, the Middle East, Asia, North Africa, and even here in Washington, Pennsylvania. Mary Montague is the 2015 Mediators Beyond Borders International Peacemaker of the Year and the 2015 Bremen Peace Award winner for public engagement. It is my distinct pleasure and honor to introduce to you this evening Mary Montague.
Thank you so much. I don't know how I'm supposed to follow that. Part of me wants to run out the door, because I was sharing a secret earlier on with people who had dinner with us, that one of my experiences in life was as a young child with teachers that didn't understand me very well, because I had dyslexia. And so I'm terrified of teachers. And here I am in a whole room full of teachers and wonderful educational people. I want to tell you a little bit about conflict, just generally about conflict and our humanness. And then I'll tell you a little bit about the conflict that unfortunately we suffered as a result of. And then a little bit about how we use certain tools to try to reduce conflict, to reduce its effects, and to try and begin to get people either to reconnect or to connect for the very first time. I'm not going to put you to death by PowerPoint, I hope, but I do have a PowerPoint, and I will try to explain in simple terms the Northern Ireland conflict or the North of Ireland conflict. What I would like to do is, sorry, clicker. It's gone. Just want to change it. What I'd like to do, first of all, is tell you a little bit about our organization. Who are we? We're an organization called TIDES. TIDES Training, like the tides of the sea. We were formed, I was one of those, there were two people who co-formed it in 2001, but I would have been working in peacebuilding from 1975. And for the biggest part of that time, it was really on a voluntary basis. What we do is training. We do mediation. So we are training on a subject that we also practice. And in mediation, I am going to talk about that in broad terms. It's also about restorative practice. And it's also about consultancy. And our vision statement, what we are aiming to achieve, is, as it says, a future of opportunities built on resilient relationships that can really stand up to conflict and difficulties. So that's our organization. I am very privileged to be accompanied on the work that we do by younger people who are very dedicated and very creative and who have helped me move in to this world of media and social media in particular. And we are looking at how social media, etc., impacts on young people in particular today, but also how it's been used nearly as a weapon, as part of conflict. First of all, I want to talk about our own humanity. I think, and I know I have done this, that very often people who use violence, we look at them and we think they are the bad people. I'm a very good person. I do not use violence. But actually, if we look into our own humanity and our own history as human beings, there is a part of us that's very much about conflict. And I say that because from the very, very early times of humankind, the humankind had to survive. And they had to survive very difficult situations. And how they actually survived, and their need to survive, began to develop conflict and conflict skills. To really survive, people form groups. And to assist survival, what happened was they decided it's much easier if there's more of us together and the synergy between all of us can keep us all safe. So they form groups. But then, of course, if you form a group, there are people who want to be a leader. So within groups, people rivaled for leadership. And a lot of the time, that rivalry would have even split groups. So it became a very, very much a part of us as people to be in groups and to have leadership within that groups and to have leadership changing and rivalry within the groups as well. They also then, if you have a group of people, there are other groups of people. And perhaps you have a lovely area that you're living on and your group is, and there's water, and there's plenty of game and plenty of animals. And another group comes along and decides, actually, you have a nice place. I'd like to move on to that. So the next thing that happens is you have group upon group. So the groups got into rivalry over territory. And unfortunately, in Northern Ireland, in the north of Ireland, we see that still today. People are rivalry. There's rivalry over territory, over areas where they live, and over a thing called the border between Southern Ireland and the north of Ireland, or Northern Ireland. And I want to draw attention at this time to my language, because for somebody who is a Catholic and feels their identity to be Irish, Northern Ireland is not the right term. The term is the north of Ireland. We are just the north of this island of Ireland. But for people who have a British identity and who see themselves as British, they would call it Northern Ireland because it's part of the UK. So even in our speech, we can be divided. And how, as a mediator, I use my speech becomes very, very important. So what happens when people are in rivalry and groups are in rivalry? Well, of course, another thing that began to develop in early days was this thing called the scapegoat. And the scapegoat is where people actually began to pick on something or on some group or on someone to really put their conflict towards and to really blame. They were the other. It was their fault. And it's very interesting that we still in Ireland, down in Kerry, have an event every August. It's called the Conglornan Fair, and they take a goat and they crown the goat. Because the word scapegoat in our culture actually came from taking a goat, if there was a conflict in a village, taking the goat outside the village and slaughtering the goat. And once the goat was slaughtered, that brought an end to the conflict. So it's a very, very old tradition, and that's why we use the term. But today, we are still scapegoating. Everything in Northern Ireland, I can tell you, is the other group's problem. Irish, Catholic, Nationalist, West Belfast is the most wonderful place if we didn't have the Protestant end of the town to worry about. Which is very sad. So let's think about it. And I'm going to ask you a question. And I just want you to think about the answer. Have you ever been in a conflict with a person, with another person? Maybe not violently, maybe just with words. Can I see a wee show of hands? Anybody in the audience? Oh, brilliant. So there's more than me? Great. And you're still awake? That's even better. What do we do when we go into conflict? Anybody like to say what they do if they're in conflict? Can I ask a question? Do you ever talk to anybody else about the conflict? Show of hands. Yeah. Do you talk to somebody about the conflict who will understand your side of the conflict? Yeah? Yeah. And whilst you're doing that, what's the other person doing? Do you think they may be doing the same thing? Of course, because we're human. And it goes right back to what we talked about. If we're in conflict, we begin to gather our allies around us. And the other person will gather their allies around them. And suddenly, what has become a conflict between two people can very quickly go into this. We have our gang. This is my gang. They understand me. They understand that my husband of 42 years is a wonderful person, but I'm the other half. I'm actually the better half. People know that. And a lot of this relates right back to where we started at the beginning, where human beings turned to create groups so that they'd be safe, and where they would find conflict is more manageable by having your allies and those around you to support you. And if we look at the world today, how we're marking our territory, and how there's an us and them, we have a world that looks like this. Loads of borders, lots of flags that indicate our nation and who we are. And unfortunately, at the moment, in Europe in particular, we have borders that have been deliberately closed to keep people out. So we are still living out what we started doing in the early days of humankind. We are still blocking out and creating an us and a them scenario. The sad thing is, the more we do this, the better we get at conflict, and the less we become at finding a different way. It wasn't just groups that we started to develop in the early days that actually taught us and began to change us because of conflict. Because the other thing that was happening was our human bodies as well. Let's think about how it feels when we're in conflict. If we're in conflict with somebody, what actually happens within our body? People might recognize this. Sweaty palms, either a red face, or in my husband's case, if he's red-faced, he's angry. If he's white-faced, I go out of the house. The pulse races, your breathing starts to change, it gets deeper, and then your capillaries and the ends of your arteries begin then to close and tighten, because if you are hurt, your body's preparing to try and save you in that way. So there's a lot going on physically within each of us when we're in really heated conflict. How we see the world narrows, and you have seen those films. It's wonderful doing this when we're working with young people, because they love those sort of very violent films that I don't particularly like, but they love them. And you see even people in the midst of a fight, and they look as if they should be dead, but they're still on their feet and they're still fighting. And that's adrenaline and all of the things that pump through our body that is there to help us survive. So when you're talking about conflict, you're talking about a lot of things happening that are inbuilt and that are very much a part of our humanness. And it's not just physically in our body. There is also something happening here. Because even our brain reacts to conflict. And chemicals begin to come in through our body that either support us to make us feel stronger and reward us if we're doing well. And it was an interesting program by a man called Winston. I'm not sure if you can still get it. Might get it on YouTube. And he was a wonderful man back in the UK who looked at human beings and how we were formed. And what he did was he put two boxers into a ring and he placed tracers on them. And the tracers looked at the change in the body as the two boxers fought. And what he found was the boxer, as one of them started to win and get the better of the other, his body actually said to him, "You're doing really well." It actually rewarded him. And people who are in the audience and who do running or who do work in the gym will know about the feel-good factor. Though that chemical that releases into your body that makes us feel great. And you can actually become addicted to it. But equally, on the other hand, the other person was beginning to have less energy. And what his body was saying to him was, ah, you see, you're a loser. You're no good. You're losing this fight. Now, did it mean he lost the fight? Well, no, because a lot of athletes are trained in such a way that they can come back and they have a resilience. But when you look at children in the playground who are in conflict, or when you look at yourself and what's happening within your own body when you're in a real conflict, all of these things are still going on. So we have to be aware that actually as peace builders or as mediators or as teachers dealing with children, that we have to consider all of this as part of their humanness and understand then in a better way how we begin to manage conflict, because we have to think of those things as well. So our poor human person that we are, what do? We have all this conflict. As I said earlier, we go into groups. And unfortunately, we very quickly create an us and them. And an us and them in a community is very destructive. Because if a community conflict like the one we experienced is very historical, that means it has very, very deep roots. And with deep roots come a history that can dictate how you feel about other people, how you see them, how you react to them, and how it becomes difficult not to justify what some of your own community is actually doing. Because you are aligned to your community. This is what they call a conflict tree. When this is happening, what we start to do is to demonize the other. We actually dehumanize them. In the case of Northern Ireland, there was a lot of domination. When the state was first set up, it was a Protestant state for a Protestant people, and Catholics were dominated within that state. They were discriminated against as well. Housing, there was great discrimination. There was discrimination in jobs. Catholics were not encouraged to be part of the police service. A lot of the high-ranking jobs, like in the law, were things that Catholics would not have been accepted into. So there was a lot of discrimination. But equally, each of the communities distanced themselves from the other, because we did mark out our territories. And even today, in housing, Northern Ireland is 94% segregated housing. So it's like a patchwork quilt. There are Catholic areas and Protestant areas. And even within rural towns, people within certain towns would know what side of the town is Catholic and what side of the town is Protestant, and they socialize and stay within their end of town. And that is as a result of a very historical conflict that really builds people and creates people that see difference and feel different. What I would like to talk about now to give you a better idea of our conflict is a little bit around the history of Ireland. But how I'd like to do this is actually by telling you a fable. In Ireland, we love storytelling. We really love telling our story, and we love, even it is a big social thing to gather and for people to tell stories, even to today. So this is a bit of a fable about Ireland. And in this fable, I'm going to say that Ireland is a woman, a beautiful woman. And that's not new. That's very old and traditional. There's a very old poem in Irish called Misha Era. Misha Era. Hug me main and hailach berach. That's our native language. It's Irish. And Ireland is a beautiful woman, and she nurtured her children, as women do. And she had four children. Four beautiful children. Ulster. Ulster, Munster, Leinster, and Connacht. So she had four beautiful children. Four green fields. There's a beautiful song, which maybe later on I'll sing for you. But she was a beautiful woman. Unfortunately, she was conquered. And she was conquered by a very strong and very powerful man who was from Britain. Now, really, in the earlier times, Britain wasn't really there as Britain, but for the sake of the story, we'll call it Britain. So this really strong man actually conquered this beautiful woman. And in conquering the woman, her children fought hard and tried not to let this happen. She had many, many warriors, and we have famous, famous stories that our children grow up on about the wonderful warriors and strong Celtic heroes. But the man established his rule, and the land was plundered. And eventually, one of the queens of England decided that the best way to bring this territory under control was to have a plantation. And what that simply meant was that people from other parts of the UK were put on the land where there was already Irish people. And the Irish people were moved off the land. So their land was given to somebody who came in, who were allied and friends of the kings and queens of England. And there was a series of plantations over centuries of the land of Ireland. But the interesting thing about Irish people in Ireland is that, yeah, people can be your enemy, but at this time, a lot of those that came on the plantation were coming from Celtic backgrounds, so people like Scottish people. And sometimes those people integrated really, really well with the locals. And there was intermarriages. However, there were also those that had a very different approach. And the approach was to really use force on the local people. So you had loads of uprisings. You had lots of horrific suffering and battles and bloodshed being caused by everyone, the Irish and the British. And eventually, we had this terrible famine. Now, there's a lot of people here would see their background as Irish. So your ancestors may have come over here during the time of the famine. They may have been Ulster Scots who came here as part two of the movement of the Ulster Scots people, because as Presbyterians, they had to leave our island as well. But there was a lot of movement of people, and Ireland has been well known for populating a lot of other parts of the world. So many lives were lost, British and Irish. And eventually, Britain decides, I'm going to divorce you. I've had enough. I'm going to divorce you. Unfortunately, the divorce wasn't quite as clean as you would have hoped, because Britain decided to keep one of the children. And the child that Britain kept was the one called Ulster. So whilst the rest of Ireland was given its independence and allowed to have its government, Ulster was not. It was kept as part of the UK. It was kept as part of Britain. And as I mentioned earlier, it was given its own parliament, and it was called a place for Protestants. And it was deliberately created to have a majority of Protestant people in that area of Ulster. Because actually, Ulster had 9 counties, but only 6 became Northern Ireland. And sometimes it's referred to as the 6 counties. Of course, then flags come into it, like we talked about before. So inside Ulster, there were those who seen themselves as British. And they're referred to a lot as Unionists in our history and today. So they are people who want the union with Britain. They are people who see their cultural identity as British, and they have the Union Jack, or the Union flag, as it should be known, for their flag. Whilst part of the population also sees the tricolour as their flag, because they feel Irish, they happen to be Catholic, and they want eventually to be part of an All-Ireland. Not all of them, but a majority of them would. So really, what happened after that was a constant, every 10 years, an upsurge of violence in this place called the North of Ireland or Northern Ireland. And each time there was violence, the bitterness grew and the division grew. And alongside that came the lack of civil rights, as I talked about earlier. So actually looking across and seeing what was happening here in America and the civil rights movement, a group of students decided we're going to have a civil rights movement. And they did. And that was the beginning of what is referred to today as our Troubles. And I'll talk a little bit more about it after this. I want to show you a little bit of video, and we're hoping that it'll work. And this, although I wouldn't totally agree with all of the sentiments in it, but it was the easiest way for me to bring you up to speed with what the last 30 plus years have been like in the north of Ireland. Okay? And that's our little health warning.
Ulster, the northern province made up of 6 counties of Ireland, made up a self-governing part of the United Kingdom for over 50 years. For most of this time, the region was at peace. However, ancient bitterness between the Protestant majority and the Catholic minority had always been growing. In 1969, the bubble burst. British politicians and soldiers found themselves once again involved in Ireland and the Irish question. The battle lines were drawn. The disaffected Catholic minority were seeking an end to British rule in Northern Ireland, where the system of government saw them as second-class citizens. The Protestant majority were determined to stay within the United Kingdom, fearful that the British government would give in to Catholic protests and force them to become part of a new All-Ireland Republic. Belfast, 28 September 1912. In 1912, Irish nationalists had persuaded the British government to give them Home Rule, which would see limited independence within the British Empire. Fearing they would lose their religious freedom due to a Home Rule government from Dublin that would have a Catholic majority, Unionists, led by Dublin Protestant MP Sir Edward Carson, signed the Ulster Covenant and pledged to resist Home Rule by force if necessary. They formed the paramilitary Ulster Volunteers and imported arms from Germany. Nationalists formed the Irish Volunteers, whose ostensible goal was to oppose the Ulster Volunteers and ensure the enactment of the Third Home Rule Bill in the event of British or Unionist resistance. The outbreak of the First World War in 1914 temporarily averted the crisis of possible civil war and delayed the resolution of the question of Irish independence. Home rule, though passed in the British Parliament with royal assent, was suspended for the duration of the war. Instead of Irish Catholics and Irish Protestants killing one another, they instead choose to fight side by side for Britain in order to kill German Catholics and German Protestants, as well as Germans of other faiths and no faith. Following the nationalist Easter Rising in Dublin in 1916 by the Irish Republican Brotherhood and the executions of 15 of the Rising's leaders, the separatist Sinn Féin party won a majority of seats in Ireland. It refused to recognise the Parliament of the United Kingdom and take their seats at Westminster, and instead assembled as a revolutionary parliament in Dublin in January 1919. Britain refused to recognise the Parliament of Ireland, but a year later, British Prime Minister David Lloyd George offered an alternative, the Government of Ireland Act. Two Home Rule parliaments, one in Belfast, the other in Dublin. Ulster Protestants agreed, Sinn Féin said no. This saw Republicans take up arms again. The Irish Republican Army and British government forces fought the bloody Irish War of Independence. A treaty in December 1921 followed a six-month ceasefire agreement. A compromise settlement was agreed at 10 Downing Street. Most of Ireland would be called the Irish Free State and become self-governing within the British Empire. The six northern counties would remain in the United Kingdom with its own parliament in Belfast. In 1949, the last formal link with the UK was severed when Ireland declared itself a republic and formally ceased to be a dominion. Through the years from 1922 to the present day, Ireland has been a divided island. Terrorist paramilitary groups such as the Ulster Volunteer Force and IRA has meant the only thing Ireland has been united in is hate.
The IRA renounced the bullet and the bomb today. They declared a complete ceasefire to begin at midnight.
There have been many attempts at peace through the various political initiatives, but so-called ceasefires never last. The problems would be solved if the people who call themselves Christians on both sides simply followed what they say they believe in.
The truth will never hide, even though I tried. They tried to take my pride, but they only took my father from me. They only took my father, even though I cried, even though I tried again.
A Protestant should stick up for a Protestant just like a Roman Catholic stick up for themselves.
Religion should be completely taken out of politics altogether. But religion's got nothing to do with politics.
A stark reminder at the very end of that, that where you have an us and them, you have death, you have destruction, you have loss, you have pain, and you have suffering. The great cost of a conflict. So what about these troubles? The word troubles, to me, really underestimates what happened in the north of Ireland, in Northern Ireland. We had the conflict up to 1998. We had more than 3,500 people who were killed. And what I would like to say is that may seem, in the world terms of conflicts, a small number, but let me explain that the whole island, or the whole of Northern Ireland, have about 1.4 million people. And a concentration of the deaths happened amongst the most vulnerable of our people and in the most vulnerable and poverty-driven areas of our urban cities and towns. There was more than 47,500 injured. And then in 1998, we had this peace agreement, which I don't actually think is quite correct. I think what we should say is that in 1998, we had a political agreement. We had the politics where politicians, and they did take risks, and they did show leadership, and they agreed to share power. 15 years on from that political agreement, we still have a very, very divided society. And we have it divided along the lines, as I talked about earlier, areas that are predominantly Catholic and areas that are predominantly Protestant. And we still have a lot of cultural conflict continuing, especially over things like flags and marching. So the conflict, how much has it cost? Division and conflict in Northern Ireland at the moment is costing £1.5 billion every single year. That's what it's costing. And it's costing that because of policing. And because, as I have said, the population is so divided that in one area there's a leisure centre, and in another area, maybe only a mile away, you have a second leisure centre, because people will not cross divides to use the other leisure centre. Our schools are totally segregated. We have a few integrated schools, but very small in number, so our education is segregated. When you have a doctor's surgery for an area, you have one in each of the areas. So even the cost of our health, because of the segregation. We have these things called interface barriers. They are usually referred to as peace walls, very badly named. They're huge peace walls that divide the communities. And they're not there to bring about peace, they are there to continue the division. And it's where, for many years, I have worked. And let me tell you the story of one community at one of those interfaces. I worked with a community, and if I had have drawn a 1 mile radius from their community house, there were 565 deaths in that small 1 mile area. So that shows you the concentration and loss of life for a community as small as that. Even from our agreement, additional barriers have gone up. Only 5% of the children, as I was saying, attend integrated schools. And still 94% of our housing is segregated. The good news is, and I'll share a bit more about it later, that we are working on that one, and we have planned 10 shared areas. This is what it looks like. This is a photograph from Belfast, and you see the red wall running right along with the white top. That is our interface. That's our peace wall. These are some of the pictures of Belfast last year. And this was during the marching season. Marching season is between July and August. And the story around that, let me explain, is where in 1690, Catholic King James was defeated by a Protestant king called King William. And there are people who remember that, and who are part of an organization called the Orange Men, and they come out on the streets and they parade. They are right to parade. It is their culture. They should have the freedom to do that. Unfortunately, in some of the areas where they are marching, demographics have changed. So where before this was a Protestant area, it's now Catholic. Now, there are hundreds of these marches, and most of them are passing off peacefully because the local Orange Lodge and the local people sit down and talk. There's a mediation, and they talk about how it will happen and the timing of it, and they look at the timing of the church services to ensure that there isn't too severe an impact on the local Catholic community. However, in other places, we're not having that. We're not having those talks. And in this area here, which is called Tweddell Avenue, there is an ongoing protest every single night about the fact that one of the marches has not been allowed by police or by a commission that looks at marches, has not been allowed to return home to its Orange Lodge. And every night we have heavy policing in that area because of that. And that's costing us money. So let me tell you a wee bit more about how conflict works and how conflict takes communities on a journey and how you or I can begin to try and change what's happening around us. This is a line, a continuum. One is showing the level of harm, and the one coming across is showing the time. So we've harm up and down that your left-hand side is the line that shows harm, and the one coming across the page is the time. So at some stage, we had the start of this conflict in Northern Ireland. As I said earlier, 800 years, if you're feeling Catholic and Irish, 40 years if you're feeling Protestant and British. But somewhere the conflict started. It's called the formation. And at the time of formation, a lot of the population aren't even aware of it because it's not impacting upon them. However, very, very quickly, the level of violence intensifies. And as the level of violence intensifies, so does a conflict. Because what do we do when there's a conflict? And we are still repeating this all the time. Where there's conflict, very often police services, governments, will respond to that conflict by heavy security responses. And if you use a heavy security response, then the conflict intensifies. Because people feel then, you see, there's the security forces. They're coming into our area. This is our civil rights. We're losing them again. And where there wasn't an Irish Republican Army at this stage, suddenly people began to talk again about the Irish Republican Army. And therefore, if people are put in the position where they feel threatened, what will they do? They retaliate, and your violence intensifies. And suddenly, we spiraled into really severe violence. We had bombings in the center of our cities and of our towns. We were heavily militarized. You couldn't go from one end of your own street to the other without meeting an army patrol. Very often, you were stopped and asked for identification. Who are you? Where are you going? And if you're a young 18-year-old, and this is your street, how does that make you feel? That this person is asking you where you're going when you've just left your own home. And it's even worse if you feel it's because of your faith or because of your cultural identity. So we really begin to deepen feelings within people, especially our young adults, feelings of rebellion. Unfortunately, during escalation, peace builders can do very little. One of the things that did happen was that we would have mass protests saying we want peace, with hundreds of thousands of people out in mass protest. But the armed groups weren't really interested in that. And the sad thing about that is, while the message is right, if you're not dealing with the issues that are driving the conflict, it's not going to end the conflict. And I was part of this mass movement. And that was a time when I was looking at others in my own community who I felt were using violence in my name and who had no right to do that, because I didn't want anybody killed. I was a nurse. I knew what families were suffering. And I also knew that the suffering from the Protestant community and the suffering within the Catholic community were the same. It doesn't matter whether you're Catholic or Protestant. If you've lost somebody you love, the suffering's the same. During that escalation, the other thing that was happening for us was that we were beginning to develop our coping mechanisms. You begin to cope with the situation. And for a long, long time, that's exactly what we did. We had what is termed a low-intensity, longitudinal war. And with low-intensity, longitudinal war, the psychological damage to the community is far greater. This is called the maintenance phase. It was termed, we have an acceptable level of violence. Now, how sad is that? What is acceptable? Is it acceptable to have a death a day? Is it acceptable that, well, actually, we only had a small explosion? The fact that there are two people who have lost their legs, who are very badly maimed, and the children witnessed it, didn't come into it. It's an acceptable level of violence. But of course, it wasn't acceptable. It was during this time, this acceptable level of violence time, that myself and my husband, when the news was on at night, we used to remind our children, this is somebody who's been bereaved. This is a family who have lost somebody. Because the violence became so normal. And you really have to work on yourself at not taking it for granted that this is okay. You have to physically work and mentally work on yourself. At this time, in the parish that I live in, which is St. Agnes's Parish in Andersonstown, we had some very serious events. There were four IRA members who were shot dead in Gibraltar by the British security forces. Their bodies were brought home to Andersonstown, and from the Andersonstown area, there was a huge funeral for these four members of the IRA. During the funeral, down in the cemetery, the funeral was attacked. And the funeral was attacked by loyalist paramilitaries, because just as we had armed groups on the Republican side, there were armed groups on the loyalist or the unionist side. And you had the security forces as well. During that funeral, people were killed. And so within a matter of a week, we had a second set of funerals from our parish. Our parish was in shock, but also very, very fearful. Because as soon as you have an attack like that, levels of fear increase. And people begin to batten down the hatches and get on the defensive and prepare to defend themselves. And that's exactly what we did. The second set of funerals were heading down the main road, they had left about 10 minutes before this incident. They had just left our parish church. And I was with the priest who had done the funeral. And suddenly the crowd came running back and the shouts were, "The funeral's been attacked. It's been attacked. Another funeral's been attacked." Because unfortunately, two members of the British Army from the Signal Regiment had inadvertently, we don't know why or we don't know what was behind this, but driven up and into the funeral. And when they left their car, they jumped out of their car, one raised a gun and fired in the air. So you can imagine the pandemonium and the response. This had a big learning for me. And the learning for me was, I ran out of that church, not to help, but to attack. I was going to defend. This was me who had always looked on those that had used violence as being, well, that's you, you use violence. I don't, I'm the nice person. But I was going out there to defend my people. And that changed my conversation in peace building. It made me realize that I have the ability to lift the gun, I have the ability to use violence. Now, what then happened? Unfortunately, the two soldiers were murdered. And someone in the crowd came running up and said, "Mary, there are two people hurt." Nobody knew who these two people were. Nobody was quite sure what was happening. And they're on the waste ground. So I ran to the waste ground, and we had a priest called Father Alec Reed. You might have heard of him. He's a person who is deceased now, but was very much part of the early days of peace building and helped to bring the IRA, Gerry Adams and John Hume together into talks. Father Alec was already on the waste ground where these two corporals were lying. And I came forward and I said, "Father, I'm a nurse, can I help?" He said, "No, it's too late." So I did take off my coat. I said, "Well, we can cover them." This was all being seen from the sky by a helicopter. Our community was then demonized within the press. We were barbaric. We had murdered. We had tortured the two corporals before they were murdered. And Andersonstown was just a terrible place. And it was very unfair, and we felt that. And we wanted to raise our voices to bring a different story to that and to bring the different narrative and let people know what had happened out of our sheer fear. But that's very difficult to do. And then on one of the gable walls, there was graffiti went up. And I often say, if you want to know what's happening in a conflict area, go and read the walls. The walls will tell you what is happening. And on the wall it said, IRA 2, Signal Regiment 0. That was not acceptable. Our community were very annoyed, very angry. And four women, me being one of them, we decided, well, we're going to call a public meeting. The reason I wanted to step up and do something was not because of me, but because of my children. We had two children. We were foster parents. And our children were at risk every day and been traumatized every day. When we held the meeting, we were really surprised. And we were surprised because hundreds turned up for the meeting. Hundreds. And we suddenly found ourselves in front of a group of people, and we had never talked in public before. In fact, most of my day, because I didn't work, I was at home with my children. I talked nursery rhymes and fairy tales and played. And here I was in front of hundreds of people. In the back of the hall, representatives from Sinn Féin came in. And what we decided to do was just ask people, how do you feel about what has happened on the wall? Anger came out. People said it was wrong. And so I challenged those at the back from Sinn Féin. I said, so can we meet about this? And we had a meeting. But my language changed because I wasn't going to that meeting to see the people who were bad and who used violence, but as equal, the people who had used or could use violence alongside me, who equally could use violence. The theme of the meeting was around what it was doing to children. Joan Burns, who's now dead, a great friend, Joan was a fluent Irish speaker, really deep in the Irish culture and very respected within our community. And she spoke about the Irish culture and how we would never put things like that as part of graffiti on a wall. We have murals, but not something that celebrates death like that. I spoke about how we were abusing our children. And this began a series of talking and of meetings. That seems very small and insignificant, and in a way it was. However, what we didn't know was that these other talks with Father Alec Reid were happening. And so there was like a spirit, a movement within this place called Northern Ireland where people were similarly working towards peace. And eventually we began to see how this could actually impact on the level of violence, and it began to decrease in our area. So there was a reduction of violence, not just within Andersonstown, but because of the work and the background work that was going on, it reduced in a lot of other places. And as it reduced, it began to give an impetus to a political movement, and Sinn Féin began to realise that actually the better way was politically. There wasn't a level of support for their violence. There was a bigger level and a higher level of support for the politics. It led into a further reduction until we have what we talked about earlier, which was our peace agreement. But during that time, what also happened was reversals. And the issue of the flags, and the issue of the parades, and the issues that still divide us are still creating reversals. And that's one of the reasons why I say we don't have a peace process yet, or a peace agreement yet, we have a political one. But we're dealing with them, and we're dealing with them in a different way. And during this time of reduction and reversals, we were very, very blessed that people came in, Mennonite people, John Paul Lederach, and trained some of us in mediation. And mediation is very simple. Mediation is bringing people into your room and allowing them freedom to have difficult conversations, but that are facilitated in such a way that they begin to hear, listen to one another, understand one another, and begin to actually be able to address issues between them. And that is very powerful. So what happens? A lot of this happened. A lot of the talking was happening. We haven't reached reconciliation yet. That's what you're aiming for. But it was happening between what we call direct actors. So we had security forces talking. We had ex-combatants and combatants. We had the politicians. We had some churches. But the rest of society, what was happening to it? Because that is very important. Because the rest of society are below the waterline. And if you think of this as an iceberg, what happens with an iceberg? The biggest percentage of an iceberg is under the water. If you only work, and this was a mistake we made at the start, if you only work with direct actors, the rest of the population are still holding the old story. They're not being given the opportunity of the conversations. They're not being given an opportunity to learn about the other or to understand the other. And what happens if you just work with the direct actors and not the indirect actors is that the top of the iceberg might melt, but the bottom's going to raise its head and it's going to pop up, and you will have another cycle, or you could have another cycle of violence. So our work today in peace building is here with the indirect actors. It's with the young people who are hearing the story of the conflict. It's with people in areas that are still very segregated and who maybe are meeting the other for the very first time, which is unbelievable, but it's true. Protestants and Catholics in Northern Ireland are coming together for the very first time. They've never had the opportunity before. But how does that relate to you? How does that relate to Washington or to Pittsburgh? Historical conflicts and the story of them are held within families. And we learned this very much in our work in the Balkans. We call this the iceberg model. And if you notice, just as it took an awful long time or a longer time for the bigger population to be affected by the conflict, it has taken even longer for the whole population to be affected by the peace building. And when I went into Kosovo and Croatia, etc., to work just after the wars, I was amazed because young men, ex-combatants, 30 years of age, told me, we do this every 50 years. And I said, how do you know you do this every 50 years? Because you weren't born 50 years ago. Interestingly enough, in their culture, because of communism, etc., they were never allowed to talk about their nationalism. They were never allowed to talk about their history. Those stories were told within the family. And if you hold a story within the family, here's how the story goes. Never forget. That's what they did to us. Now, I grew up in a divided society. My mom and dad never told me not to like Protestants. In fact, until I went to work, I never really met a Protestant. But I'll tell you, without anybody teaching me, when we went out to the discos and we were dancing, I would go, hello, what's your name? Because that would maybe tell me. Where do you come from? That's possibly going to tell me. If I still wasn't sure, I would go, so what school do you go to? Because that was surely going to tell me. I wasn't doing that to dislike the person in front of me. I was doing that to find what it was safe to talk about. Because I wasn't going to talk politics, and I certainly wasn't going to talk religion. And that's called tacit culture. And that's what's held under the watermark on your iceberg. So what's the story in your community about your American flag? About your Confederate flag? What's the story that's held about the division in social status, in being gay? What's the story held in your family around religion? Because we are human beings. In Northern Ireland, the armed groups did not come and land from Mars. They grew up. They were part of our community. And where there's conflict, and where there's an out-group or an in-group, an us and a them, we do run the risk of having conflict and paying a very high price. This is called the iceberg model. It's a good name when you're a peace-building organization and you're coming from Northern Ireland where we built the Titanic. The good news is it doesn't have to be that way. There are principles that if they guide your work and what you do, regardless of your professional background, you are a peace builder. And the principles are very, very simple. And it's our name. Everything that we do, we are working towards transformation, towards change. Difficult to change a society, but you're working towards change. Interdependence. If we're not going to be an us and them, the first thing that you have to recognize is that you are dependent on the other. And to give you an example of that, in the Balkans, one of the areas I worked, one of the mediations I did, was about a river. And the river ran through a totally Albanian village into a Serb village and so forth. And the Serbs and the Albanians were both terrified about who might tamper with that river because they were very dependent on the river for their crops. And we were able to bring them together in conversation because of the river. And there was a real realization that they were totally independent, interdependent on one another. The cleanliness and the care of that river and to make sure nobody backed it up from anywhere or any side became their goal. And they were able to build relationships out of that. Diversity, it's lovely, isn't it? We all love to celebrate diversity. Let's celebrate it. Let's hug one another. Diversity is very hard. It's very difficult when somebody presses that buzzer, that little trigger in you, and you realize that this person's culture is actually a wee bit alien to you. So it's hard. It's hard for me to be in a room with orange men who are telling me they have the right to march. That could be a trigger. In a way it is. Except I understand more about their culture because I've talked to them. We have to be aware that diversity is difficult. The way to overcome division about diversity is to make sure you have the widest diversity you can have in the room when you're talking. And not just diversity in the way of culture, but for example, let's take your schools, your young person, your vulnerable family. How do you look after that family? How do you look after that child? Can we as a group of professionals be in the room together? Can the teachers be in the room with the social workers? Can the community be in the room with the teachers and the social workers? Can the family be in the room with the teachers and the social workers together? Can we approach this through multi-stakeholder forums? Because that's one of the richest things that has come out of our peace building in Northern Ireland. If we want to effect change in our society, we have to do it in respectful partnerships, using restorative approaches where our conversations and our communication is really out of respect, acknowledging each person's gift and strength and what they bring to the table, and ensuring that we're all working together strategically and effectively towards a goal. It's a wonderful and very powerful thing. Difficult to do, but very worthwhile. And then we talk about equity. And equity is not just about equality. It's about more than that. It's making sure that whatever we do, we put in a system that will embrace the change and support the change. So for example, a Bill of Rights. And it's great having rights, But we just can't think of the rights. We also have to teach that if you have a right, you have the responsibility for my rights. It's a bit of a different conversation. We have the right. Orange men have the right to march, but they have the responsibility to the community that they're marching through. The community they're marching through must allow, they have the right to live there in peace, but they have the responsibility to allow the orange men to have their cultural expression. And if you frame the conflict in that way, you can change it. So we have to remember about equity and the systems that we need put into place to deal with whatever issues we're dealing with. And if we do all of that, we're going to get a sustainable peace. That's what we have found. We're working in areas where we have sustained low levels of violence to actually no violence, where this has been successful. It's about restoring right relationships. We come right back to the mediation and the restorative stuff. It's all about listening, about trust building, about myth busting, about dialogue and storytelling and education. And let's just look at the myth, because I love the myths. See, I started this with a fable. Irish people love storytelling and they love fables, and we have loads of myths. And one of the myths we have is, I can tell that you're a Protestant because your eyes are closer than mine. You didn't know that. Another myth is that actually King William, had a great battle where he defeated Catholics. Until you go into history and look and find out that actually King William's troops were paid for by the Pope of the time, and a lot of them were Catholics. And that was one of the myths. I told this to a group of women. We were looking at history, Protestant women, and one of the women said afterwards to me, Mary, I'll never feel the same about the 12th again. What are the myths in your community? What are the myths in your school? What are the myths in your neighborhood? What are the myths about the people at the moment who are using heroin? What are the myths about police and people that are black? What are the myths about Muslims? Are all Muslims people that go out and bomb? Is that a myth that's held within your gut or within your head or within your community? So we're restoring right relationships by blowing away the myths, by dialogue, storytelling, and education. And I'm running over time, so I'm going to just let you read that. These are all the wonderful things that we as mediators do. We're fabulous. We carry out assessments. We assess the willingness for people to come in the talks. We do back channeling work. I love it. My poor husband used to drive me to meetings where we were doing back channeling work. And that simply meant I was meeting men with woolly faces. And I was putting into place the safety to be able to do some constructive work in an area. So you go and you speak to the key people that you need to speak to. And that can be the armed groups. That might be the police. That might be the politicians. But whoever you need to talk to ensure you can do a piece of work and keep a community safe, if they're coming to meet the other, you have to do it. That's the role of the mediator. We design processes. We'll work at getting the agreements and how we're going to go about it. And the best way as a mediator is to have the parties design the process with you. Because you're not there knowing everything. And you're only there to facilitate. They have to own the process. And they also have to own the resolution. The solution will come from them. It's amazing how creative people are if you give them the opportunity. It's very hard sometimes because you'll sit in a room for maybe 2 hours when you're thinking, if they would only say this, if they would only think of that. But if I say it, it doesn't belong to them. I have to wait till they tell me. You're doing conflict analysis and mapping. That simply means you're looking at the dynamics and the players. And the greatest thing that worked for me as a mediator, both in Balkans and in Northern Ireland, was where we mapped the conflict together with those that were in conflict. Because suddenly they could see and understand the other, even out of the mapping. So it's really, really effective. You facilitate. And the important element that I would say in the way that TIDES approaches peace building is a training. Because when we go in and work in an area, we are also training people to be mediators, to use restorative approaches. Many, many of the interface areas that I have worked in no longer require me. They're doing it for themselves. We set up a thing called a mobile phone network where one community activist can be in contact with the other and in that way minimize things like rumors. And they're able to come together and talk and they no longer need me. That's why I'm here today. I've done myself out of a job, which is good news. Mediation is also about maintaining relationships because, like the issue that I talked about earlier in Tweedell Avenue, sometimes if areas do get very tense, they do like somebody, like myself, that they have a relationship with, to come back in, to support them, to listen to them, and to begin to think about ways to address the issues again. These are all the things that are still challenging us as mediators. The ongoing violence where there is. In a lot of areas, mediation is about criminality. It's not gangs of armed groups and political violence. It may be gangs around criminality that a community is having to face. An increase in antisocial behaviour and an increase in opposition at home to our peace process because some people are feeling that they never seen a dividend out of the peace. So why should they support it? So we do have Republicans who are disengaged and who still want to fool all Ireland. And we still have within loyalism and unionism people who would say, we've actually lost. We lost this war. We've gained nothing out of it. Poverty's worse in our area, unemployment's higher, and we were superior, and now we're not. So work like that has to be faced up to and worked through. Our young adults are not voting. Our young adults are not interested in politics. Our young adults are more interested in other things. Should I say? I'll not actually name them, maybe it wouldn't be right. But, and one of the things that I'm concerned about where our young adults are is the fact that they are listening to romantic stories. And they are saying things to us like, I wish I had been born 40 years ago. I could have been a paramilitary. I could have went to prison. I could have fought for my country. I want to be a patriot like my father. And that's where the telling of the story that I talked about earlier becomes crucial. And the easiest way for us to address that is to actually have an ex-combatant with us who will say to the young person, so you think it was wonderful, do you? Do you know what it's like to be in prison? Do you know what it's like when they come to your door of your cell one morning and say, by the way, your father died last night. And by the way, you're not getting out for the funeral. What's that like? So you're bringing home a reality to those young people that I can't bring to them. So never underestimate people who have been through your prison and how useful they might be in educating your youth. Changing the narrative is what we are about as peace builders. And not burdening our youth and our children with our stories of division and hatred, so that we do see the, sow the seeds for another conflict. We're trying to create a shared vision with space for all. These are the things that we're trying to do. Changing the story is so important. How do you stick at this? There are times when at home I come home very disillusioned. My poor husband's there. He does the cooking and he tries to pick me up with his meals. That's why I put on so much weight. However, what I would say is we do have a sense of humour in Northern Ireland. I'm going to show you a piece of film, which is a comedy show from Belfast, from Northern Ireland, about flags. But I want just to explain something to you. In this, the word flags, you may not hear it very clearly, because it's talked about in Belfast, flags are actually flags. That's our accent. So we fly flags. All sorts of flags. And a couple of years ago, there was a union flag that flew at the City Hall every single day. And our local council is now a nationalist council, more so than unionist. So they decided they'd take the flag down. And they would only fly the flag on certain times of the year. And they would fly it when over in other parts of the UK they fly the flag. So like the Queen's birthday. Now that was a big step. The Republicans were saying, well, we'll fly the flag on the Queen's birthday. But unionists went mad. And the interesting thing is that a lot of them didn't even know that that flag was flying. 24/7, 365 days a year, because it's against a beautiful old building and nobody was noticing it. But it has led to such an amount of trouble that we are still mediating it today, 2 years later. But let's look at what the comedians made it to be.
It's the first time ever in the Blame Game we had an idea what might come up. So, this is not a flag.
Right.
This is
a flag.
Richard.
The people who have this flag, suddenly the people who like this flag
took
this flag down off the City Hall.
Nobody noticed it was there until they took it down. Then, 6 weeks of mayhem! 6 weeks of mayhem because the people who love this flag are going,
they have taken my flag! Taking my identity. I don't know who I am anymore.
Flags are more complicated because you may be in a part of Belfast, you'll see that flag, but we just don't go for two flags. Oh no, not in Belfast. No, no, no. We like lots of flags. We love lots of flags. You'll get that flag. Okay. You'll get that flag, and you'll also, on this side, you'll also get that flag. Even though both those flags are already in that flag. The lunatics with this flag, they decided to adopt this flag. Oh, yes. Because they are growers in the revolution. They are similar to us, only with a suntan. They are with us, we know. So because these ones took that flag, these ones then take that flag. Because my enemy's enemy is my friend.
Can you imagine being a tourist wandering through Belfast trying to work out what's going on? But it gets better. Then this flag gets involved. The Italian flag. Do you know why the Italian flag got involved in all this? I think you do.
Tell me.
Willie Fraser can't tell the difference between those two flags. Willie Fraser.
Now, go on, Willie. A haircut from the 1960s and a brain from the 1690s. I love Willie. Willie saw this flag, the Italian flag, in a primary school. And stick it for this flag.
What was Willie, doing in
the primary school? I don't even want to know what Willie was doing at a primary school.
Going home for lunch.
So Willie said it was a probie training camp for youth, and that's the thing. Because like Batman and Robin, you have to have Willie and Jimmy Bryson. Now Jimmy does not call it a flag, or
a flag.
Jimmy calls it a flag.
They have taken my flag. They have taken my flag away. Where is my flag? I thought I saw a pretty cat. Did the pretty cat take my flag?
Richard Haas has arrived, and he wants to know from the public what we could possibly do to help the situation.
So that's our flag situation. And Richard Haas is an American diplomat who came over and actually tried to have conversations about some of the issues, one including the flags. Ladies and gentlemen, it's been a lot of listening from me, a lot of talking, and you've been very kind as to listen for so long. We're going to have some questions and answers. But just before I finish, I want to tell you a story about how children can really hold the answers to our situation, any conflict situation. I worked with a young boy, Brenton, who was only 6 years of age. He was very traumatized. He actually came into our after schools club because I worked with over 1,000 children who were traumatized through our conflict. And he bounced off walls. He was so traumatized. And I had this wonderful tape box, because you don't know, I have a magic tape box. And it's covered in silver paper and stars. And if you hold it, you can be anywhere you want to be any person you want to be. So Brenton, I handed him the tape box and I said, who would you like to be? Where would you like to be? This is a magic time. We can do and be wherever we want to be. And he said, I want to be the person in charge of all the fighting because I want to stop it. This is a six-year-old. And I want to take all the guns and I want to throw them in the sea. And I want to take all the bad blood, and what he meant by that was blood that people had lost because they were hurt or killed. I want to take all that bad blood and put it back into people so that my friend Patrick's daddy can come back. Because if my friend Patrick's daddy comes back, my best friend Patrick will come back and live beside me, and I'll have my friend back. The story behind that is that Brenton and his little friend Patrick actually witnessed the shooting of Patrick's father on at the doorstep of the home. And not only were they traumatized by the act of violence and the shooting and the death of Patrick's father, but Brenton was traumatized by the fact that it led to him losing his best friend, because his best friend and the family moved from that home. So never underestimate the story from our children and never underestimate their wisdom. He was 6 years of age and this was years before we ever got to a ceasefire. Thank you.